And it helps if you plug in all the cords so that you can hear me. And so we're grateful for that as well. And so the walk for life, the blessing box is great. And then I wanted to remind you that on Wednesdays we are continuing our Zoom Bible study at 7 p.m. And if you are interested in being a part of that, you are welcome to get us your email address. You can text it. You can call us here at the church building and leave your email address. You can email it to us, however it works for you. And then we'll send you the link to be able to join in the Bible study. And we are currently in the Gospel of Matthew, and this week it'll be chapter 12. And if you want to just come and observe the first time that you're with us online, that's fine. You can do that, kind of check it out, see how things are going. That works out too. So all of that, and then I also want to remind you that on Thursday at 4 o'clock, we're doing our youth Zoom meeting. And so same thing kind of applies. Give me your email address, and we can get you connected. But young people, we're getting really close to being back outside in the parking lot doing some fun things. So hopefully we'll be able to get to that. And coming to the end of this month, now that we're in April, at the end of this month, we are very hopeful that we're going to be able to put together our parking lot bowling tournament. And that sounds like a lot of fun, and we'll have prizes and have a good time with that. So all that to say this, welcome. Thank you for being here this morning. I'm Brian. We are grateful that you are taking part in our service, and we're going to move right into worship music with Christy, Zach, and Taylor.
Thank you for joining us this morning. Put your hands together in your car, in your home, wherever you're at, and let's worship our Jesus, and let's lift up his name this morning.
Hallelujah.
I get to talk in the fancy mic today. I'm moving up in the world. Good morning, church. Happy Easter. Happy Easter. So, happy Easter. Amen. That's right. Okay, so obviously today we're celebrating Easter. And I was thinking about my prayer this morning, or in over the past week, a lot of times when you see the cross and you see it on somebody's necklace, obviously it's a sign of Christianity. But for me, and the more I think about it and the older I get, to me this is more a sign of, sorry for the wind. Anyway, the cross to me is a sign of love. And oftentimes we see people that wear necklaces that are in the shape of a heart. Well, for me, when I see the cross, to me it's more of a sign of love. So as you go through this week and you run across others, be reminded that this cross, not only is it a sign of Christianity and what Jesus Christ did for us, but think of it as a sign of love that we are meant to share with everyone around us. And make people ask, what is it? Why are they so happy? And share that love with others. Pray with me. Father God, thank you so much for all of your glory and all of your goodness. Thank you for all of our friends and family that are here with us, whether it's in the parking lot or whether it's online. Thank you so much for your blessings. Thank you for Brian and Christy and Zach and Haley and Josh. Be with us all as we are here to share your words, your goodness. Watch over us this week and help us to do your will and to be an example of your love. It's in Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. All right, this song is Graves into Gardens, and it's kind of a new one for us, but we were super excited to bring this to you so that way we can worship together. We're just here together for Easter Sunday, and not just to celebrate Christ's death, but the resurrection, that his grave was turned into gardens. He makes beauty out of ashes, and all things are new, and he works all things together for good. Amen? So worship with us this morning.
A man's empty prayer.
great. I love it when we have new music, and Christy just throws it out there, and Zach and Haley, and it just comes together so well. You turn graves into gardens. That's what Jesus does. That's how it works. And aren't we glad? Aren't we grateful? Aren't we grateful? So, at this point in the service is when we, once again, will share our connection with Jesus through communion. And so, I want to share with you what that exactly means as far as what we're looking at for our connection with Jesus today. And, you know, I came across something posted on social media the other day, which really kind of got me to thinking. And it said, you know, the other day I was thinking about what it would be like if I knew tomorrow was my last day. What would I do if tomorrow was my last day? Would I eat all the things I wanted to eat? Would I go to the places that I'd never been? What would I do? And then I got to thinking that Jesus knew on Thursday that Friday was going to be his last day. And what did he do on Thursday? He washed feet. Jesus, up to the end, served. A servant Savior. So that was Thursday. Jesus had the Last Supper. Jesus served by washing feet. And then Friday. Friday was the day the light went out. Jesus died on the cross. And you know, many saw it happen. Many of his disciples saw it happen. They heard him cry out. And along with him died the hopes and dreams of his followers. They saw him take his last breath. You know, it was a real punch to the gut. It was so heart-dropping. It was the most difficult thing they'd ever seen, and it was going to be so hard to get over. Then, on Saturday, the sun came up, but it felt like everything was lost. It was game over. The Messiah was dead, gone. The Pharisees got what they wanted. The threat was gone, and the Romans were still at the top of the heap. But God. Now let me back us up several centuries before the birth of Christ to Joseph, and Joseph speaking to his brothers, you know, his brothers who sold him into slavery. He said to them, "You planned evil against me. God planned it for good, to bring about the present result, the survival of many people." That was Genesis chapter 50, verse 20. In much the same way, God used the most horrific form of execution, murder actually, crucifixion, to save the eternal lives of many. God has a way of flipping the script, and the resurrection of Jesus, it defeated death. It's the greatest script flip of all time. While God uses the weak to shame the strong and the foolish to shame the wise, he has also used death to bring everlasting life. Friends, we serve a great and infinitely powerful, just and loving God. So while you may look at your life and say, "For me, it's game over," I suggest instead you focus on the cross and put your hope in a Savior who is risen. And as you take of the bread from this morning's communion, remember that he gave up his body, he gave his life for you. And so when we take of the bread, we remember that he was bruised and beaten for you. Let's pray. Lord, thank you so much for the opportunity to come this morning and to worship. Thank you for the sacrifice that you made for each of us. Lord, you gave up your body, your earthly life for us. And today as we take the bread, may we remember your broken body. As Jesus broke the bread with his disciples, we remember that your broken body took the place of ours. Thank you so much, Lord, for taking our place and paying the price for us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. So this morning I want you to remember something. I want you to remember that we celebrate Easter because the tomb was empty. On April the 4th, 2021, I want you to know that the tomb is still empty. Jesus is risen. He is alive. And we can celebrate in that. He went to the cross. He paid the price. His blood has redeemed us. And as we take of the cup, may we remember the blood that was spilled. May we remember that there was pain and anguish and blood involved in making each of us righteous. Let's pray. Lord, thank you so much for providing the only way that could ever save us from our sins. Thank you for taking the beatings, for taking a death that you didn't deserve, but we did. And for giving us righteousness that we don't deserve, but you do. We are so grateful. May we always be doing this in remembrance of you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cherish.
Service when we would normally receive our offering in the sanctuary, and those of you who are here and regularly come and attend on Sunday mornings in the parking lot know that what we have done is we've set it up so as you exit, the offering box will be then at the end of the sidewalk. And so we are reminded today that God has given us a great deal. He has given us a sacrifice that was his son. And so when we think about the things that he's given us otherwise, the resources, the home that we live in, the clothes that we wear, the food that we eat, we are reminded that while God's resources were shared with us, he encourages us to share as well. And so the church continues to do the work in this community and actually, honestly, in other parts of the world as well, as we are in the process of drilling another well in Haiti to provide clean water and Jesus Christ to a community that doesn't have either. And so we're really excited about that, and that's part of what we do through Christ Church, as well as share gospel tracts and Bibles with people in Eastern Europe, with reach people in our community through serving them with food and other kinds of support. And so a lot of things happen in and through this church body, in and through you. And so we are grateful for all that you do and the gifts that you give that allow us to continue that work. So thank you. Lord, thank you for the gifts that you give us. May you continue to pour into us that we may pour into others the love that you give us, whether it be in time, talents, or resources. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So this morning, I want to ask you a question. What was the worst moment of your life? I know, not exactly the way you'd expect a sermon to begin on Easter morning, but think about it for a minute. What is the worst moment of your life? Now, I certainly have more than my share of moments that could qualify. When I was 16, I had a 1973 Camaro. It had a powerful 350 engine with a four-barrel carburetor, which meant it was fast and used a lot of gas. It was a stick shift, and it had something called posi traction. And posi traction means that when I would accelerate, both rear tires would spin at the same time, not just one, but both of them. And honestly, it was a lot of car for a kid who'd just gotten a driver's license. Now, at that time, I had a job working at a grocery store, and it was one of those situations where I needed the job to pay for the car, and I needed the car to get to the job. And of course, I had to buy things for the car, you know, the gasoline, and of course, big tires, the fuzzy blue carpet that I put in the back window. And, you know, it was a lot. It was a lot of responsibility. It was a lot of car. So right after I got these new big tires put on my Camaro, I took them with the expensive flashy wheels that I had saved up for, and I drove this car. And I took it over to my friend who worked at a gas station a couple of blocks away from my high school. So after school, I went there and I gassed up and I showed off my new purchase to my friend, the wheels and the new tires. He was suitably impressed. So as I left the gas station, I revved the engine and popped the clutch and spun both tires. It made quite a noise. And I fishtailed out into the street, left this trail of rubber on the pavement. I mean, it was loud. It was loud. The only problem was that I did it across the street from the police department where there was a parking lot full of officers. You see, it was shift change. And needless to say, one of them tracked me down a few blocks away and wrote me a ticket for something called disturbing the public quiet. It was not one of my shining moments. Fortunately, I was significantly and sufficiently humbled by the officer and the traffic stop, and I stayed where I was, even though while I was sitting there and the officer was in the car, his car, behind me, writing up my ticket, I ignored the elementary school kid who came by on a skateboard and said, "Go for it. Get out of here. Take off." Still not one of my shining moments. You see, I've got a resume of dumb things that I've done. And honestly, I'm pretty sure that my list of worst moments is longer than yours. So now let me flip the question. What was the best moment of your life? Was it the day you made the team that you were trying out for? Maybe it was the day you graduated from high school. Or the day you got that college diploma. The day you got your dream job? Or was it your wedding day? Or the first time you laid your eyes on a brand new baby son or daughter? See, our lives are made up of many best and worst moments. One of my wife's worst moments in life was one of my favorite moments. Just a short time before Joetta and I were to get married, she was having a great deal of pain in her side. And we went to doctor after doctor, trying to find out what was going on and get it diagnosed and taken care of. And we went finally to a surgeon friend of mine who did some tests and diagnosed Joe with a bad gallbladder. So just before we were to get married, in a hospital in Lamar, Joetta had surgery. It was successful. It went well. But Joetta felt pretty awful afterwards, as most people would after that kind of surgery. I would say that if you asked her on that day or a day or two afterwards, it's probably one of her worst moments. It wasn't the case for me, though. Sure, I hated seeing her feel badly, but I was grateful for the chance to be able to take care of her. And honestly, for me, it was an opportunity, to take care of her and show her by my actions that I was, well, husband material. Now, I imagine she'd tell you that she already knew I was husband material, but maybe it was me who wasn't too sure. I may have just needed another chance to show her, and yeah, probably show myself, that was the case. So Joetta was in pain, she was groggy, and she wasn't able to care for herself after her surgery, but I was able. I was able to get her into the car, drive her home from Lamar as she slept, get her medications for her pain, and put her to bed. Isn't it interesting how one of my wife's worst moments is one of my favorite moments? You know, the same could be said for Jesus and for you. His very worst moment, the crucifixion, it became the Father's favorite moment in the resurrection. I have to admit, I absolutely love the Easter story. I especially love what happened at the tomb on the third day, and I'd like to share that with you from the Gospel of Matthew. So we're going to be in Matthew chapter 28, beginning in verse 1. And it goes like this. Early on Sunday morning, as the new day was dawning, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went out to visit the tomb. Suddenly there was an earthquake. For an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and rolled aside the stone and sat on it. His face, it shone like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. The guards shook with fear when they saw him, and they fell into a dead faint. Then the angel spoke to the women. "Don't be afraid," he said. "I know you're looking for Jesus who was crucified. He isn't here. He is risen from the dead, just as he said would happen. Come see where his body was lying. And now go quickly and tell his disciples that he has risen from the dead and is going ahead of you to Galilee. You will see him there. Remember what I have told you." And the women ran quickly from the tomb. They were very frightened, but also filled with great joy. And they rushed to give the disciples the angel's message. See, early on Sunday was the first day of the week. Some of the women who followed Jesus, they went to the tomb so that they could anoint his body with spices. You see, they were fully expecting to find the lifeless body of Jesus lying in the tomb. Jesus being raised from the dead, it wasn't even on their radar. But they encountered more than they were expecting, didn't they? Oh, yeah. An angel in bright white clothes whose appearance was like lightning came down and rolled back a stone and took a seat on top of it. The stone that had been used to seal the tomb, the one that the angel was now sitting on, was not rolled aside so that Jesus could get out, but so that others could get in and see that Jesus had indeed risen from the dead as he had promised. This angel, though, the one on the stone, his appearance was like lightning. Can you imagine the brightness of lightning emanating from an angel? It wasn't some 10,000th of a second flash of lightning in the sky like we're used to. It was a constant of that kind of brightness. It would be really tough to look at. Brighter than the sun. And this was no cute little cherub or diaper-clad Valentine Cupid angel that we're talking about. This was such an astonishing and fearsome angel that the guards who saw him were terrified and passed out. What amazes me about that, and what should amaze you as well about who this angel was, is that these guys, these soldiers who passed out, they would have had military training. They probably would have seen battle, and they just dropped in the sight of the angel. They were out. So let me ask you, when's the last time you were so scared of something that you passed out? This was a big deal. Then the angel spoke. He announced to the women shocking news, the news that would change all of history. It would change absolutely everything from then on. Jesus, who was crucified, was not in the tomb. Then there was this statement, the statement that causes my heart to jump every time I read it. It makes me want to go, yeah! And it should give us all great hope. And it was spoken by the angel. The angel said, I know you're looking for Jesus who was crucified. He isn't here. He is risen from the dead, as he said would happen. He isn't here. He was here. But now he isn't here. Those three words, he isn't here, they changed everything. They are the basis and the foundation of Christianity. They are the foundation of our faith. It is such a big deal that the Apostle Paul wrote to the church at Corinth, and he said this, if Christ has not been raised, then your faith is useless, and you are still guilty of all your sins. But he is. He said he would. Jesus, who was crucified, was not in the tomb. He had risen as promised. See, even Jesus' enemies knew that he had claimed that he would rise again from the dead. That's why they wanted a guard posted at the gravesite. But Jesus' disciples and apparently these women, they'd been slow to understand and believe. And isn't it amazing that the desire of the Jewish leaders to keep the body of Christ in a sealed tomb was exactly what God wanted to have happen? When the tomb was opened and Jesus wasn't there, well, when that happened, there's just one thing that could have happened. Can you say divine providence? When I was growing up, I don't know about you, but this time of year I would go to church and people would greet each other and they would say, he is risen. And then the response would be, he is risen indeed. And I always thought, that's kind of weird. I thought to myself, they were saying it wrong. Shouldn't it be he was raised? I discovered much later, though, that the reason for saying it that way is because Jesus still lives. He was raised from the dead, but Jesus himself is risen and always will be. This is so good. This is such good stuff. Let's step back for just a second, though. I want you to get another overview of something. Let's look at the four things that the angel told these women. The first thing he said, don't be afraid. Number one, don't be afraid. See, the reality of the resurrection brings joy. It doesn't bring fear, it brings joy. And when you're afraid, I want you to remember the empty tomb. There's comfort in knowing that our King has defeated death. Number two, he isn't here. My three favorite words. And actually, one of the other versions has four words. He is not here. But you get what I mean. Three awesome words. He isn't here. Jesus is not dead and is not to be looked for among the dead. He is alive with his people. And you know what? He still is today. Jesus lives. Number three, come see. The angel told the women, come see. The women were invited to check the evidence for themselves. The tomb was empty then, and it is empty today. The resurrection is a historical fact. The angel invited them to take a look for themselves, to peer into the empty tomb. What a glorious sight that must have been. Number four, the angel said, go quickly and tell. Go quickly and tell. The women were told to go spread the joy of the resurrection. And that's still true today. We are also to spread the great news. So this angel, he had commissioned the women to proclaim Jesus' resurrection, proclaim it to the disciples, who, by the way, at this point were hiding behind closed and locked doors. You see, the disciples figured that if the Pharisees got to Jesus and they killed him, well, then the rest of them must be on the Pharisee hit list, ready for similar treatment. So the women, what did they do? They left in a hurry. And not only that, but they were both afraid and filled with joy at the same time. They headed back to tell the disciples about the resurrection. And as they ran, I can only imagine that they were trying to wrap their heads around what had just happened and make sense of what they had witnessed. You see, nothing else in all of Christianity has any meaning whatsoever if there is no resurrection. I recently had a conversation with a young woman who's not a believer. And I used the illustration that I so often use. And I told her that Jesus had said more than once that he would be arrested, beaten, spit upon, crucified, and then he would be raised from the dead after being buried in a tomb. Luke 18, it says this, taking the 12 disciples aside, Jesus said, listen, we're going up to Jerusalem where all the predictions of the prophets concerning the Son of Man will come true. He will be handed over to the Romans and he will be mocked, treated shamefully and spit upon. They will flog him, whip him, and kill him, but on the third day he will rise again. I told this young woman that Jesus had said that upon his death, he would be buried, and then on the third day, he would be raised from the dead. And then, after saying that, it happened. It happened like he said, the resurrecting part. Well, he pulled that off. No one prior to that time had ever done that, and no one has done it since either. So when someone tells you that he will be killed, buried, and then raised from the dead, and he pulls it off, well, then I'm thinking we should probably go back and reread all of what he had said and taught before. And I'm pretty sure I'm going to believe what that guy had to say if he told me that he was going to come back from the dead and he did it. I got to think everything else is the truth too. And let me share another way. Those of you who know me know that I'm really into sports, and I enjoy a lot of different sports. And so let me give you a bit of a sports analogy. So if a batter in a major league game comes up to the box and raises his bat and he looks the pitcher in the eye and he takes a minute and he steps out of the box, which basically is calling a timeout, and then he looks the pitcher in the eye and he takes the bat and he points it to center field. He's basically telling the pitcher, that's where I'm going to hit my home run. I'm going to hit it over the deepest part of the center field fence. And he steps back in the box. And the pitcher now knows what the batter says he's going to do. And the batter once again raises the bat. And that very next pitch, the batter swings. He gets a hold of all of that ball. It sails not only over the middle of the center field fence, but it continues to go completely out of the stadium. It just keeps going. I don't imagine that pitcher will be pitching to that batter again anytime soon, do you? No, probably not. You see, because when that batter comes up, they're going to put him on base and do their best to avoid having to face him, because he told them that he was going to do something amazing, and then he did it. Jesus also has been telling those around him at this time what was coming. But they didn't seem to believe. They didn't believe what Jesus was saying. They heard the words, but just didn't seem to register. So the angel said he was here, but he isn't here now. He was dead, but he isn't dead now. I honestly cannot think of anything in my life that gives me more hope, more encouragement, than to know that Jesus, the Son of God, who was sent to save the world, defeated death. And not only that, but if you believe that he is who he says he is, and if I believe that he indeed was raised from the dead, then I too will join him in my very own resurrected body. Don't you want to do that too? That's why around here we get so excited about baptism. It's nothing to be afraid of. Baptism is a symbolic picture where you participate in the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus, where you take all of your worst moments and you hand them to God, God who created you, and then he turns it into your best moment. Baptism is our chance to obediently respond to what Jesus did, what God did through him, and to publicly declare our allegiance to the one who is dead, was dead, but now lives. And by way of the Holy Spirit, he lives in you and me. More than 2,000 years ago, our King defeated and destroyed our greatest enemy, death. Let me close with this. Pastor Max Licato, pastor and author Max Licato, in his book entitled When Christ Comes, explains it this way. In Romans chapter 6, verse 9, the Apostle Paul says, when Jesus was raised from the dead, it was a signal of the end of death as the end. The resurrection of Jesus is an exploding flare announcing to all sincere seekers that it is safe to believe. Because of the resurrection, everything changes. Death changes. It used to be the end. Now it's the beginning. The cemetery changes. People once went to say goodbye, but now they go to say we'll be together again. Even the coffin changes. It's no longer a box where we hide bodies, but rather a cocoon in which the body is kept until God sets it free to fly. In John 14, verse 3, Jesus says, I will come back and take you to be with me. And to prove that he was serious about this promise, the stone was rolled away, his body was raised from the dead. There is no greater news, no greater announcement than God's proclamation that death has been defeated. Easter, Resurrection Sunday, it's the day that love defeated death. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you so much for giving us the hope that we get from the resurrection, the hope that we have because of Christ's return from the dead. Death could not hold him. Death couldn't keep him from doing what he needed to do. The devil thought, aha, I've got him now. But Lord, you flipped that script. And now we know that as we live and breathe, and these bodies no longer function, that our life continues. And it continues with you because of the work of Christ, because of Jesus, and because of the resurrection. We know that from here on out, it only gets better. In Jesus' name, most powerful resurrected name, we say, amen.
Is crowned with glory now.
Resurrecting me. Can you honk for that? Yeah, that is amazing. Amazing. The resurrection of Jesus points to our own resurrection. All we need to do is believe and stay close and be obedient to the one who went to the cross for us. Thank you so much for being here this morning. And you know, we sometimes talk about wanting to have the spirit of Christmas all year long. Well, I would say that what we really want is the spirit of Easter all year long. We want to resurrect not only the world around us, but our hearts inside of us, so that we are able to live as such in such a way that it's obvious that the Holy Spirit lives within us. You know, some people think the Holy Spirit is like this little flicker of a candle that's inside of you. And I tell you this, it is not that. It is a rocket ship that you need to let burn and get moving with the Spirit. So this morning, as you exit, as you go home and spend the rest of Easter enjoying this wonderful weather and family and food and however you celebrate, remember that it was the cross that brought us to this place, that we can be free from sin because of Jesus. You know, if he doesn't come back, if Jesus wasn't going to be resurrected, none of it means anything. It's all based on him. And aren't we grateful? Have an amazing rest of your week. I look forward to seeing you all again back here next Sunday. We're getting closer, I promise. We're getting closer to the building. But we still, now we have some good weather, first time in shirt sleeves since like October, which is nice. So we're grateful for that. And I'm grateful for each and every one of you. Thanks for being here. And may God bless you and your family.